agenda. We've got an agenda, but I don't have a copy of it, and I think we're going to play it by ear. But I think Bob is asked to go first. And you want to say what your topic is?
Are you testing?
It's a 15-minute video of Arecibo. I don't know. Do people know what Arecibo is? It's a big satellite dish, so to speak. Okay, not a dish, but it's astronomy.
It's built into the mountain.
Radio telescope is what it is. Built inside of the mountain in Puerto Rico. So there's a program on Twit TV, which you stream if you want to watch it. It's called Ham Nation. And Ham Nation is a weekly hour and a half program that does ham radio stuff. You should watch it. Just go to Twit, TWIT.TV, and there's probably, I'd say, a dozen programs. Of those programs, each one of those is Ham Nation, and you can look at the last 300 issues of Ham Nation on there in an hour and a half if you got enough time in your life. But this was a trip that the people from Ham Nation, Val, who's NV9L, did to Arecibo. So it gives you a little appreciation for ham radio. The frequencies, this will never disappear. The primary use of this dish is to monitor asteroids, okay? And as you know, asteroids are probably the most dangerous thing we have around us. And if anything were to do in the Earth as a whole, it would be an asteroid. So they monitor these continuously. And when somebody spots one, they go up, they orbit, see how close it's going to get, chemical composition. But that's what this is used for. It's used for other things. So they're doing atmospheric studies with it, and they do stellar stuff, do star stuff.
Okay, so that's the introduction. That's agenda item one. Pete, you're going to do the next item, right?
Yes, and then Eric is going to follow up.
Okay, and what you're doing is?
Analog and digital. What's going on, and how can we connect? And we're going to connect.
Okay, you're talking about audio, analog, and digital.
Yep.
So this new digital modes over the, what's it, voice over internet or
voice over IP? There's a lot of people here today. Right. Wow.
Yeah, we've got
just standing up the hall now.
So here. Eric, is this Eric?
Yes. Hi.
Hi, Eric.
So we're just gonna basically follow on Pete to do a quick repeater update and kind of go over what the plans are for this year for the repeater system. And it's all kind of tied into what Pete's doing. So.
Great. I don't know if you were told, but when Ken and I were doing the class, the fellow that introduced us or got us a whole bunch of students and asked Ken to do the course, mm-hmm. works for Exxon, and he offered through his work from Exxon, free space on a bunch of towers in this area. And it's all news to us. It's,
wow.
It's stuff up in, I understand, like Rangeley and Craig and that sort of thing, and maybe on the Grand Mesa. We don't know all the locations. He just made the offer. It was something they want to do as an outreach to community or whatever.
Let's
and
do it.
Yeah. I asked
all in favor. See what we've
exactly.
Got.
I just asked for just give us something in writing so that our our repeater tower committee can look at it. I assume we have such a. And Kevin runs that, I suppose. Where's Kevin?
Right.
He's hiding.
Oh, right there. Okay. So, is that the last item?
Yeah, and it won't be very long.
Okay. So, that's well. I have a feeling that'll be the meeting. There'll be VE testing for anybody that came to take an exam in it. Can I see a hand, bro? Show of hands of anybody that wants to take an exam right now?
I think Ken got everybody in a three-state area last week.
Who's taking the test? Who wants to take a test today? Nobody.
I haven't seen any hands, so that's kind of, we're prepared to do that. But if we don't have anybody, we don't have anybody.
Everybody's in that
shirt. Now, there's a bunch of announcements that we needed to make. First one of which is, Kevin's got a card for Eric Rosenquist, who I don't know if you know what's going on with Eric, but he hasn't been here for 2-3 months. sign it. Bob and I had a bunch of photos taken. By the way, mine, you can't read the call sign on a little sign we put in front of the empty chair because of the flash. So the thought is we send it to Ken. He'll Photoshop his call sign on it.
That's
how did your pictures turn out?
I'll keep talking about it.
Okay. All right. So
not a problem.
So that activity is going to be going on during the meeting. I think Jerry wanted to have an announcement made about MS Walk.
Yeah, you want to do that right now?
Yeah, we're just starting.
Okay, the MS Walk is scheduled for here at the high school on May 20th, and I need about half a dozen people to help me with that. So anybody who's available on the 20th, if you can get a hold of me sometime after the meeting or so here, so I can know who you are and put you on the list here, okay? I see several people here who've done it before. If they want to do it again, that's great. But anyway, please get a hold of me after the meeting.
we had 17 people who tested and 15 who passed. And so hopefully, and the results were in the mail by Monday night. And so
great.
Anyway, we're just right now waiting. And I also see a few of the people that tested here at the meeting. So
would you raise your hand those that tested last week?
Thank you. All right. Well, welcome aboard. Now, I understand they get a year membership in the club, so we hope to see you at least 11 times, 12 times. Oh, and let me say, just mention it, but Field Day is a really big event. It's going to be up on Missouri Heights, and it's an opportunity for you to operate as well as observe all kinds of different modes, you know, all over the ham bands and capabilities. And there will be stations that you can actually run yourself if you feel comfortable with it. And I would suggest that you do one of the go-to stations. And Ash, he's not here, but he usually runs all of that, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, we're trying to augment it a bit this year so that there'll be better opportunities for newbies to get involved. Are there any other announcements before we just go to introductions?
Thank you to Ken for running the course.
Yeah.
Code
Gary, AC0UZ, I'm from Glenwood.
Eric, K0JEG, Battle of Mesa.
Bob, K0ALN, Aspen.
That's all right, Bob. Go ahead.
It's chaos.
And very close to Sophie.
Yeah, very close.
Peter from Newcastle.
Joe, 80CF.
Stan, 80FMJ.
these things are out there working and playing together today. So I want to make a few points up front so there's no confusion. It turns out that you don't need a digital radio to do digital radio. Because of some work some amazing people have done, they've been able to figure out how to cross-connect different systems, which we will show you. So using just a little Bofang and little Chase Mertz here, you can actually, in our club right now, you can actually do some digital radio things and start to experiment with it. So you don't have to buy a $600 proprietary radio to get started with it. So with that, let's begin and talk a little bit about what the heck is Allstar and why do I care? Well, it's oversimplified. It's an adapted radio technology that allows individual nodes, which is a little Raspberry Pi computer and a radio that hook together. That would be a node, a Raspberry Pi computer and a radio. To hook together, you can communicate back and forth, or you can take entire backbone systems that we have today, repeater backbone systems, and hook that into the Allstar system as well. So you can do a single node, which is a Raspberry Pi, and a radio, or you could take an entire backbone system with the right architecture and hook it to another backbone system, and you can talk over the internet anywhere you want in the world with good digital quality, and the band's always open. So our friends on the Front Range at the Rocky Mountain Ham Group have done some interesting things with Allstar software, and they've got a repeater system that's online today where they're actually using some Allstar software to hook together different repeaters over microwave links, and Eric's going to talk about that, so I'm not going to steal his thunder. But my point is, with this Allstar software, you can have nodes or you can have entire repeater systems that play together, okay? And it's not very expensive, and it's not very hard to do. I did it, okay? Okay, so this is a little picture of what these nodes look like. They have a bubble chart, they call it, in the Allstar world, and it shows you, in any given time, real time, what sort of node is hooked to what, okay? So this is just a little bubble chart I took of a connection that I made into Troy, Alabama, at the Alabama Hub. We'll learn more about that in a minute. And these little nodes here can be as simple as just a Raspberry Pi and a radio. The club hub that we have now that's running in Vail, there it is right there, is just basically a Raspberry Pi with power and an internet connection. And we're using that to hook together different nodes in our geography here so that these different nodes can talk to each other. So all you need is a Bofang, a little Allstar node, and you're ready to go in our repeater system or all over the world. You don't have to have a digital radio, okay, to do some of this stuff. Okay? So we'll get into that a little bit more in the next couple slides. All right. Okay. What constitutes an Allstar node? Well, these are the basic components of what you need. This is a $50 little Raspberry Pi 3 kit you can buy on Amazon for $50. Shows up in 2 days if you're Amazon Prime. And you also need this little tiny board that's $50 that is a USB interface to the Raspberry Pi down here. And then this is just a standard issue DB9 connector that goes to your radio. And it's not hard to hook up. The radio, you need a radio where you can pull off certain signals out of the radio to get it into this board that gets it into the Raspberry Pi. And all you need are basically five wires: ground, transmit audio, receive audio, press to talk, and COS. Okay? So it's not that hard to do, and we'll show you that working here. There you go. Okay.
COS.
Carrier operated squelch. COS. Did I get that right, boss?
Yeah.
Good. Still faking them out. Okay. So this is a picture of the radio that we actually have. The club has one of these right now. I chose this particular model radio because I bought this little connector. The guy who originally showed how to do this on the internet said, here's the part number. So I bought this connector. Comes out to about six wires. And then you wire it up to this little DB9 connector pulling out the right wires. And here's in the pinouts here. The white is ground, two is yellow, is transmit audio, orange is COS, blue is receive audio, and black is press to talk. So you run these wires into the correct ports on the DB9 connector that goes into that little board, and you're hooked up and ready to go. It's not hard. I did it. And I don't have any soldering skills. Frank can attest to that. And my wife will tell you my color vision stinks too, but I still managed to figure out how to connect it up. But it's not hard, and it's not expensive, as you will see. making QSOs between here and Hawaii over your little handy talkie from this room, because it's all online and it's operational now. So this is some of the different kinds of things you can do when you start messing around with digital radios and analog radios and internet and things like that. It's a different part of the hobby that we haven't as a club done a whole lot with right now, and I'm trying to get the people interested in some of this stuff. It's not hard to do, and it's easier than you might think. The software that runs on the Raspberry Pi is free. You download it from the internet. It's no big deal. Let's back up here. Okay, whoops, I'm going the wrong way. Wrong way. proprietary digital systems, including Allstar, and cross-connect them in a hub down in Alabama. So you could take this little Bofang and your Allstar node that you built for about a couple $100, key it up, and you could talk to anybody in on a Yaesu system and or a D-Star system all at the same time. And when Eric and I got started with this a couple of weeks ago, I was slightly ahead of Eric in terms of discovering this thing, but we had a QSO between Eric and I. I came in using a little DMR radio from Avon. We hooked into the Alabama link over the internet, and he was on D-Star, and we were talking to each other on completely different digital systems because they were all cross-connected here at the Alabama link. I had no idea this capability existed, but these are some of the things that the guys are working on now. I'm certain that there will be guys in Southern California soon with the Southern California link working on the same kind of thing, cross-connecting these different types of digital systems. D-Star, Allstar, they even have an Echolink node that you could come in from your cell phone and talk to these other people across the planet. So it's pretty amazing.
Are they linking any HF into it too?
They haven't yet. There's been some discussion about that, but my understanding from reading is that our HF rigs don't have carrier-operated squelch. So without that capability, I'm not sure how exactly we bring HF in.
In the LA group, we've been experimenting with the same thing. We are able to get D-Star, Echolink, and local 2 meter. But the problem was in LA, 2 meters is so limited that
right.
It was only in the Inland Empire and couldn't get to the Santa Monica area. So, but that's what we're working on, but we're trying to incorporate a little 2 meters into it.
Right. So, I mean,
so
obviously.
They haven't done that yet.
Right. But the guys in Southern California will be catching up to where I think the Alabama guys are leading right now worldwide, I think. I haven't found anybody else that has all these different modes cross-connected right now and working. These guys have that working right now. They call it a multi-mode digital and analog hub. So one of Phil's challenges to me was, I don't think the club should take off in any direction where we end up obsoleting somebody's radio. Well, we haven't done that. What we've done is opened a new door, so if you have an FM rig and you don't want to buy a digital radio, well, you don't have to. You can still join the party and interoperate with these people. Okay? The guys down on the Front Range in Denver now, they've got a big DMR network up there. If you drive down there and you program your little DMR radio, if you want to buy one of those for $100, you can go down to the Front Range and speak DMR digital and talk to them over their repeater system if you want to do that. They already have that working on the Front Range. Okay, so we have a great club here, but on the technology curve, we're a little off the curve, but we're catching up. We've got some nodes now, and we're trying some different things. So I hope some of you guys in the room will want to get a hold of these Raspberry Pis or use the ones you already have and start experimenting with some of this stuff, because it is pretty darn amazing what these things will do. And you don't have to have a digital radio to do digital radio, thanks to the guys at the Alabama Link. They've got their own Facebook page, as you would imagine, and all that kind of jazz, but they've really done some outstanding engineering, in my view, down there. I had no idea you could do this. DMR stands for Digital Mobile Radio. It's another standard of too many standards in the digital radio world. I have one. It's a little MD380. It's $100 on Amazon. It's one of the least expensive and most capable digital radios. That's a whole nother presentation on DMR. I don't want to get into that. I just want to open the door and open the eyes so you guys can see these different pieces and how they play together. Okay? Okay, so again, this is another little ad for my friends down there at the Alabama Link. But they interconnected all these different proprietary
fine too, though. It also does HF and 220, and you know,
okay.
It's not just, you know, it's an APRS respirator.
All right,
but it is way overpriced for what.
Yeah, I mean it's twice as much as what we spent putting together this note. So the little radio that I knew how to modify, it's all on Amazon. It's under $130. $7 for a plastic box enclosure. The little Raspberry Pi was $50. The hard drive for the Raspberry Pi was $8. DB9 connector, the little ring light DB9 connector that interfaced with the radio, that was $50. But the whole point is, for well under $300, okay, you can get into the digital game big time, and it works with your little Bofang radio. You don't have to go buy an expensive digital radio first, okay? So my offer to the club is this, is I went ahead and bought all this stuff and put it together with Kevin's help, got it running right now, operational, at Kevin's QTH. So if the club wants to keep this note or not, it's up to you guys, it's not up to me. I'd ask to be reimbursed for just my cost of the equipment there, and then it becomes a club asset at that point. So it's up to you guys whether you want to keep it there and play with it on the backbone or not. It's really, it's up to you guys, whatever you want to do. So, okay, so that's
just
what the cost is. It's not expensive, and you got to do a little bit of your rector set work to put it together. That's half the fun, but when you get it to work, it's nice.
Different resources.
Okay.
Okay. Pete?
Yep.
Is the note that's up now, is it accepting, can you work D-Star on it?
No.
Not yet.
Okay.
Just through the Alabama stuff.
Yeah, if you want to do the cross connection right now, we have to go through the Alabama link. We don't have an Alabama link here yet. You know, walk before you run.
Okay.
And we're kind of like crawling, walking right now.
$8.
Okay, and then this leads into Eric's pitch here, which I'm not going to talk about. Eric's going to talk about that. But they're doing some extensive work using some of the Allstar linking with Allstar software, microwaves between repeated towers and stuff like that. And they're already integrating this stuff and running this stuff and being able to manage it remotely, because it's an IP network involving computers and Allstar, they can do certain things remotely at the repeater sites that we can't easily do today. We don't have any easy way to get up to, for example, Anvil Point today and adjust levels that desperately need to be adjusted. In the future, we hope to have a digital system similar to what they're doing on the front range, so we have that added capability. Okay, so should we try to do the demo now, or should we wait and bring in Eric?
Let's do the demo.
Eric says let's
demo.
Do the demo.
Okay.
That's what he mumbled?
Oh, okay,
demo.
Yeah. Hey, questions on any of the stuff here?
I have something to piggyback when it's an appropriate time. I don't know if you want to do the demo first. Or
well, let's try the demo. Let's see if anybody's awake in Hawaii right now. See if anybody's around. I don't know. Phil, do you know any guys on HF that are out there and off the top of your head in Hawaii?
K6LC.
Whoa. What? K what?
K6LC. I don't know if he operates above.
KA6LC.
Kilo Hotel 6. That's a call sign for Hawaii.
Okay.
Yeah.
K6LC.
We in the turtle.
He doesn't operate above.
Okay. Well, let's see if anybody's home.
I don't know if he operates too.
Just tell somebody you're doing a demo and give you a read.
They've got a pretty good link system between all the islands and one.
Okay, so this is the screen.
Yeah, they're probably thinking about their first couple of
coffee. Oh, that's okay. Okay, so this is the control screen from our server hub that's operational now in Vail, Colorado. And my friend Alan has a very, very fast internet connection, thanks to the Comcast. And our hub server exists out there right now. So our hub server's number is 45479.
Can we see it?
Can
we
see?
Oh, well, sorry. This is, pay no attention there, man. Sorry, the IT guy.
There we go.
Maybe.
Did I get it?
Take a
that's out in Australia or something like that, just as a demonstration, so you guys on your regular old FM analog things could talk Allstar to anywhere else in the world and just see how this stuff works. So I could bring the link up, which brings in the whole repeater system into somebody else's whole repeater system in Germany or the UK or Australia, and then you guys could play with it, and we could, you know, schedule that for an hour before our net, and we could bring it up, try it, all everybody could try it, and then we could knock it down before the normal net so we're not all cross-linked into that.
The only thing there is that it's 2 o'clock in the morning,
so Sunday,
and
3 in Germany.
Right, insomniacs.
Australia is in Europe.
Okay, well, you know, I can hook it up to wherever. That's not a problem. If you have a particular suggestion, or yeah, Richard would be in the middle of the night, but you could probably talk to when everybody's back in Britain there, and
I understand the language.
Yeah.
How do you go to that repeater system and ask permission before we do this? So
that's totally what I would do. Yeah, okay. Yeah. I mean, you want to be courageous. You don't want to get banned or anything like that, but.
Yeah.
You can tie together a whole bunch of systems very easily, and it can get pretty exciting. The group Frank and I have identified up in northern New Hampshire, they've done a lot of things with Allstar because they have similar problems to what we do. In northern New Hampshire, they've got winter up there, and they have repeater sites that are hard to get to and stuff, so they've built a lot of their nodes up there on just basically connected Allstar nodes rather than depending exclusively on a mountaintop repeater system that's hard to repair or reach. So it's just a different way of doing business, but it's one more example of how guys are using this Allstar digital technology to help solve problems that we have here, which is access to these repeater sites in the wintertime to make needed adjustments. So, Jess, go ahead.
The other thing we're finding with the digital radio, you were talking, I think earlier somebody was talking, Clark, about bringing new techs, especially the techs into the ham world. With digital, they can get on, and they don't have restrictions of the band plan and things like that.
That's true.
It opens up a whole other world to the techs, especially, to get in and explore something that on the HF side they'd be restricted on.
That's true. Absolutely true. So would you guys like to try that at some point in the future? I can send out a blast email. We can take our repeater back with permission and hook it up to Hawaii or somewhere else and, you know, do it an hour before the normal net. You guys could kind of check it out and say, oh, that's cool, that's neat. And, you know, and then bring it back down and we could do our normal net. So
can we use Echo Link to get into that?
Excuse me?
Yeah,
Echo Link is part of our backbone.
Yeah, it's a great idea.
So just this goal is to just expose you all to this. I'm hoping somebody will want to buy some of these things and learn things that I don't even know yet, and then they do a presentation in 2 months.
So if you use a digital radio, that's more expensive, do you have better audio going in and out?
Oh,
than you would
gigantically.